Hello and welcome to BusyWorksBeats.com. Today I'm continuing the Giving Game series here at BusyWorksBeats.com. And we're going to answer the question, is music production career worth it? Is your music production career worth it? So today I'm going to go over four main sectors of music production and how to think about your business, because now you are a business. You know, you need to stop thinking of yourself as an individual person. You are a business, so you need to operate as a business operates. So, you know, one of my mentors said, never rely on one source, one medium source or one source of income. And that's because if one source or one medium falls, like for example, MySpace disappeared overnight, everybody hopped over to Facebook. Now, if you were, for example, the artist Cassie, let me write this down before we forget. So here's some points you need to remember before we begin. Never rely on one source or one medium. And I'll define the difference between source and medium. So source, we're talking about source of income. So let's just draw a money sign there for source of money. Never rely on one source, because let's say MySpace disappears overnight in popularity. And then people move to Facebook. And if your whole business is built around MySpace, you're now basically out of business because MySpace decided to, or people decided to move over to Facebook. So now you're catching all the heat from MySpace disappearing as far as popularity. That's why you never want to rely on one specific site, one specific person, one specific source of income. You always want to create multiple flows. And all the top mentors talk about it. Grant Cardone, if you're familiar, talks about multiple flows of income. You know, different authors write about multiple flows. And we're not just talking about income sources. We're just saying multiple sources of possibilities of making money. That's what I mean. It doesn't mean that you have passive income and real estate and all these different things. I just mean that there are many ways to get money in the field that you work in. And I'm going to make those more aware as we move forward. Now, Jay-Z also said that if he makes his team millionaires, if everybody in his team is a millionaire, right? You have Jay-Z and all his associates, you have Dame Dash, you have Memphis Bleek, you got, you know, the whole Rockefeller team, Beanie Siegel at one point, State Property and all them. So he says he's going to surround himself with millionaires. So if he has a hard time during a season of life or just during a month or two, his friends, his associates, his team can lift him back up for falling. He's creating what's called a community. And this is what is built inside of a lot of religious communities. For example, the Jewish community does this extremely well. They donate to their charities and they say, okay, if a certain person over here is struggling, we're going to lift them up in their hard times. We're going to give to this charity so that that money's put aside for people who are, you know, in hard times at the time, and they lift them back up in good spirits. And that's how they fuel their community. So these are key points. Before we even get into the career of music production, you need to understand these two key points, because these are going to sustain you through your mindset and your decision making. So let's move into the first aspect of music production career. So I'm talking about the modern producer. I'm talking about producers who are online, who are even in their city, and just who want to understand the bigger things about music production. So let's focus on the biggest source of income that's probably going to be your best friend for a very long time. And this is what we're going to call licensing. Now, this is also similar to publishing, but when we talk about it in music production, we mean two different things. So when I'm speaking about licensing, I mean how to license or lease. This is a very common term people use as well, to lease out your music or to, you know, talk about exclusives. But exclusives are a little bit different, and it depends on how you word your terms, et cetera, et cetera. So let's focus on licensing. This is where you take one item, your hard work. Let's say you spend 4 hours and you create a Drake beat. Okay. Now that Drake beat, you can license to millions of people, hundreds of thousands of people. You can do it over and over and over and over and over again. You still hold what's called copyright. Okay, so licensing gives you the ability to hold the permissions to the track, meaning that you own the actual track. Licensing allows you to multiply that track to other people to let them use for things like mixtapes, different projects, videos, marketing products, you know, adding into their, you know, there's a billion and one different uses for music. Okay, so that's what we're doing with licensing. So you say, okay, for a flat, I mean, licensing changes. Okay, it's not always the same. Some people ask for equity, some people ask for a flat fee. In most cases, we're talking about a flat fee. So you're going to say $20, you're going to lease out or license out your Drake beat for $20 to anybody who wants to license it out. And they can use it for their videos for YouTube or Vimeo, whatever platform they use. They can use it for their products. If they're building some type of, you know, school project, they can use it in the background. They can use it on their mixtapes. So it's not just artist to artist. It's producer to anybody who needs music. See, that's where your most producers are limiting themselves. They only think artist to artist. They only think of this, mixtapes. There's a billion and one different uses for music. Go on YouTube right now, just for example, type in some random word, and I guarantee you the first video has music in it somewhere. Chances are, okay? So music can be used in all platforms that are visual, that are audio-based, and even in feeling-based platforms nowadays because we're gaining a lot of technology that's based on vibration. So, I mean, music has so many reaches. It's almost impossible to put it into one video how many uses of music there are. But in short, licensing allows you to take your time, let's say 4 hours that you spent, and then you're going to license it out infinitely, meaning it has no time limit. That's where you escape time. And this is what I suggest you do early so that you can get in the habit of getting out of what's called the rat race, which is basically working for exchanging your time for money. So here's what most of us started out with, even myself, okay, the rat race. You're exchanging time, and I should put a little thing here. You're exchanging your time for money, right? But what licensing allows you to do is step out of time. So now you're not exchanging time for money, you're exchanging value for money. And you completely rid time out of the equation. So you don't have to sit there hours and hours and hours every day to do the same exact things over and over. You can just invest 4 hours of your time, create a product, and then license it out however many times you can. So that's the magic of licensing. And licensing is even on the major level, and that's what we call publishing. So I wanted to use two different terms because I don't want to confuse quote-unquote industry stuff with, you know, independent stuff. So if you haven't noticed, the quote-unquote industry, and I have videos on this, but you are a part of the music industry, regardless of if you're signed to a label, regardless of if you're in LA or New York, regardless of you're in Nashville, regardless if you have your own studio, regardless if you have your own artist, or if you produce for any quote-unquote majors, you're still in the music industry. Okay, so don't let that term, you know, make you feel lesser just because you're not in those places or working with those people. You are in the music industry. Now you have your own marketplace. You have the internet to build out your brand, and you can take stuff offline. But my point is, now it's open to everybody. It's not just a couple people. You're now in the game. So you're in the industry. Let's move into the second portion, which we're going to talk about publishing. It's a little bit different, but it's the same exact thing. Okay, so don't get too overwhelmed. Now, publishing is a little bit different because it's a system, okay? Now, once you step into the system of action and music, this is where you face the consequences of the system, right? A lot of people are complaining about YouTube and about iTunes and about, you know, Tidal, all these places being unfair. But the point is, YouTube owns their platform. iTunes owns their platform. Tidal owns their platform. They make the rules. You know, the users don't make the rules. So when you're a part of their systems, you have to play by their rules. So a lot of music artists are complaining about that but they've totally forget that they decided to join their platform. And an artist who's getting out of this platform, for example, just so you can research later, is an artist and producer, Ryan Leslie. Now, he talks about this very articulately, and I'll explain it how he, I mean, we already explained how he does it. He licenses out his own stuff, basically. He does that first step of things. And he also has services, which we'll get into next. But he said, forget the iTunes game. He said, forget the, you know, standardized way of doing things. He's going to do it his own way so he can play by his own rules. And he took ownership of his own work. So it goes deeper than just, you know, the platforms and percentages. It also goes into ownership. But I don't want to confuse you with too many words about business because everything I say has an even deeper meaning. So I don't want to get too deep into things. So let's talk about publishing. Publishing is a little bit different, even though it's the same thing as licensing. When you say publishing, it means something else. So publishing deals with copyrights, and it deals with revenue based on those copyrights. Okay, that's the easy way to kind of explain what publishing is. It deals with people who've put their work into a work, their hours into a work, or their effort into a work, and it's also the revenue generated by that work and how it's distributed to the people who put in their efforts into that work. So it's about copyrights and it's about revenue. So in short, how the system works for publishing is you have two what they call 100% pies. And the reason they have two pies of 100%, which still makes no sense because this confuses so many people. The reason they do this is because it's easier to divide percentages when you do it this way. If you had two 50% pies, it'd be harder to divide the math. So that's why they use two different 100% pies. In short, you have a pie for a songwriter, songwriter. Now, if you've noticed on, let me hit Control Z real quick. If you've noticed on ASCAP or BMI, you can register as a songwriter or another person called a publisher. So this is where the term comes into play. Now, publishing is a complicated word because it's confusing, right? So what publishing means is it's a person who distributes a work, and distributes means gives it out to people. So it's the person who ultimately sells the work. So think of it like this way. You have Walmart and you have people who make products for Walmart. This is the easiest way to understand it. You have products like Febreze. What else is cool in Walmart? Wrigley's gum. Okay. Et cetera, et cetera. Now these people pitch Walmart on selling their products. So the people who make the products, these are called songwriters. And this is why I stress so much when I talk about producing, you are a producer of a product, and that product is a song. So you're considered a producer, okay? Someone who makes a product. Now your job, if in this case, in this system that you can choose to be in or not, okay? Now when you create a product, that product is then pitched to a place like Walmart. And Walmart in this case would be a publisher. So what does Walmart do? They have a storefront, meaning they have a place where they can sell stuff. They have customers who are interested in the things they have to sell, and they have marketing, et cetera, and promotion. So that's what they do. The publisher is responsible for getting the record sold, basically. That's just how it works, okay? The publisher gets the record sold, whereas the songwriter just makes the product, okay? So it is an even exchange. When people say, oh, it's not fair that the publisher gets 100%, well, the song wouldn't sell anything if it didn't have good marketing behind it. It wouldn't sell anything if it didn't have a storefront. It wouldn't sell anything if no customers were interested. So the publisher's part of the pie is just as important, if not more important, than the songwriter's portion. So that debate can go on for decades and decades. But the reality of it, it's you're creating songs to make money. And the people who make the money are usually the publishers. And I say usually because songwriters can promote as well. But ultimately, the publishers are the ones who are, you know, generating the money for the record. So since the whole game is to make money, publishers, in this case, I believe, have more of authority over the situation. And that's why they demand more percentage, usually in different agreements. So a songwriter, I'm just going to give you a very, 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 very basic explanation about publishing and why there's two 100%, because it still makes no sense to have two 100%. And I'm not going to talk about publishing deals because that'll just take up way too much time. I'll give you a gist of it. So let's say this way. In publishing, you have songwriters. A producer is considered a part of the songwriter side. You're not the publisher. Unless you register as a publisher and publish under your entity, you're not a publisher. By default, you're a songwriter. And same goes with the artist. Same goes with the songwriter. And this is why you hear a lot of people saying that they've created the publisher side of things so they can get a percentage of the other side of this pie. Okay, so the producer, the artist, the songwriter, the musician, all these guys split one 100% section of a song. And let's just call it 50% because that's what it really is. So all these people are splitting 50% of the revenue of a record. By default, 50% is the max, okay, because you have two 100% sides. Publisher, songwriter, okay? So whoever made the song, whoever made the beat, whoever wrote the lyrics, whoever played the instruments are assigned to 50% max. So that means the producer can ask for 30%. And this is probably a bad example because I have three different people to split 20%. That was probably, let's add somebody else. And lyric, let's just say lyric person. Okay. So let's say the producer basically made the record, you know, like Metro Boomin's beats are kind of what makes the artist hot. So let's say he charges 30% of his songwriter's fee or whatever. Now everybody else has to split the remaining 20%. So now the artist gets 5%, the songwriter gets 5%, the musician gets 5%, and the lyricist gets 5%. Now you can split this any way you want. These are called, the thing you would do that on is called a split sheet. I don't know why my thing is acting up, but a split sheet is where you break down, or a cue sheet, depends on who you're talking to. Split sheet or a cue sheet goes through your entitled percentages. But remember, the max value is only 50%. Okay. Now on the publishing side of things, you can only have one label, right? And they get 50% by default. Because they're doing, but don't, you know, it is entitled. So don't think that, you know, the record label's stealing all our work. The record label, you know, the publisher's taking all our percentage. You have to remember that the song would have never been sold if it were not for the publisher. So they deserve a lot of the record because they're the ones selling it. You know, you can make the best song in the world, but it could sit on YouTube and have 12 plays. And I've seen that before. I've seen great songs have under 1,000 plays, and it just boggles my mind. It's because they don't know how to sell their music. So that's where publishers come into play. So even if you go from that 1,000 plays, it could be the best song in the world, but with a publisher, you can take it up to 11 million plays and however many sales that could be. So that's a dramatic difference. So to me, that 50% is just due, okay? If not more. So that makes sense. So let's say you have one label, they could take their own portion of 50% of the record. So again, it's split 50-50. As far as the record goes, publisher and songwriter, but then you have to split that amongst all the people associated with each side. So that's why you have two different registrations as a publisher or as a songwriter on things like ASCAP, and these are called PROs. You don't really need to memorize what a PRO is, but it's a performance rights organization. They basically organized, okay? So they fight for your rights and the laws, and they do all that type of stuff down in Washington. Because that's important, because whenever you organize as a people, you want to make sure that you have your foot in politics, because politics makes the rules. So you want somebody who can represent you as far as making the rules. So that's what, you know, these companies do. And they also fight for your just due revenue. They have things called SoundScan. You know, I don't want to break it down into a billion different lectures here. The point is, publishing deals with a system. Okay, that's the whole point of this whole video. It's a system. It's already made, and you decide to join it or not. You don't have to join the system. It's just a system. Okay, so do not believe that you have to do deals and do, you know, deal with labels and do publishing deals and all these type of things. If you don't want to be in that system, you don't have to be in that system, period. Okay, so let's move into the next. Now, okay, so, and another benefit I meant to point out for publishing is that this is what we call the majors. This is what all the majors basically use. And Chance the Rapper, not sure if he's involved with these. I think he just doesn't have a label, but I think he does deal with, you know, publishing and percentages. So I'm not sure of his business side of things. I haven't studied him. So this is another side of music. And this is what most people want to get into. They just, you know, they don't know the benefits and the, you know, the pros and cons. Okay. But remember that point, never rely on one source of income, never rely on one medium, never rely on one person. That will always dictate your decisions in each of these branches of music production and your career as a music producer. Okay. So let's move into the next field, which is services. Now, here's what most music producers actually do, okay? And there's a pro and a con to this, so you just have to be aware of the pros and the cons. So if you remember in the beginning, we talked about licensing and how you are escaping time. But when it comes to services, you're right back to exchanging your time for money, okay? So you only have 24 hours in a day. You can only do so much per day. So with licensing, you can actually escape the day. And this is what all millionaires and all the, you know, wealthy people talk about, is escaping time. You want to get paid while you sleep. How do you get paid while you sleep? You license, you automate. Okay, so this is, or you build systems to go on as you sleep. Okay, so it goes beyond this. But, you know, in short, with services, you're right back to the rat race, which is exchanging time for money. Now, it's up to you how much you charge for your time. Now, here's where it gets crazy, because, I mean, how much do you charge for your time? That's based on the value you create. So some people do get their just due for their time. And in that case, it makes up for all the time that they spent. So it's not a rat race in that case. But anyway, I don't want to confuse you with all these business terms. Let's start with services. What can you offer as a music producer? The most common thing a lot of people do is they record. You can offer recording. So this is where people rent out your studio space. Okay. Now, under recording, you can have a whole different, whole bunch of other services. I mean, you can get as creative as you want. For example, you can do, you could just do rent out studio. You can do rent out studio with service, meaning that you're actually going to do something in the studio. So in this case, this would be exchanging your time for money. But the first one, your time's not involved. Okay, so this is actually, the only time is involved is scheduling the person. But they're going to be in the studio. You don't have to be there. Okay, but the second one, if you're renting out the studio with whatever service, it could be mixing, it could be whatever. It could be helping them record. That's going to take up time. So you might want to charge a little bit more. Okay, so let's put a price table here. So here's one charge. Here's charge plus. And if you're recording in a studio, you could also do two services. So I'm going to say rent out studio, ROS, rent out studio, plus two services. Or have other people come in. And that would be money plus plus. So that's a higher price. Then you could have people come in. They could rent out instruments. They could rent out musicians. Okay, so let's say two services and then a musician. I mean, it's literally infinite on whatever they need in the studio. Okay, so that's, you know, running a studio, it's a business. And that would be your highest ticket price item. Okay, now the thing about studios is there are a lot more home studios than there are big, lush, you know, million-dollar facilities. And that's a good thing and a bad thing at the same time. Because the quote-unquote customer base for those big studios, people who didn't need to go to the studio now don't go because they don't have that need. But people who want to go to those studios for a specific quality, they want to go to those studios because they're trying to create a specific sound, okay? But people who can sacrifice a little bit of quality, but they don't need the big studio, they can do it at home. And this is what you can do. You can operate at home. You don't need to have your own commercial real estate, you know, paying a lease and then paying for equipment, paying for power, you know, probably an insane bill. So that's the difference between home versus, let's write this out, home versus commercial real estate. Okay, so you can build a studio in your basement or you can lease out a facility and then build a studio in there. Infinitely more pricely on this side. Okay, but now they're not getting that easy money of people needing a studio. Now people can do it at their home. Now they didn't lose business. It's just that the people who didn't keep up in the big studio game fell off because they thought it was just easy, the same business. Just buy equipment and have a business. Not anymore. It's not like that anymore. Okay, so that's one service you can offer is recording. Another service you can offer, mixing. I'm just giving you ideas. I mean, you can literally offer any service. It can be putting up websites. It can be doing graphics. I mean, there's literally anything that has to do with artistry on here. So you can do mixing. You can help them with actual songwriting, which is what most producers want to do. They want to be in the studio, artist to artist. So this is where you charge a flat fee or, you know, whatever your agreement is, or even free sometimes. And, you know, flat fee or let's say free with publishing, meaning free with a percentage on the back end. Okay, that's a decision you have to make. Are you going to charge a flat fee of, $500 for somebody to come in the studio with you and make a record off from scratch? Or are you going to be free up front with, you know, 30% of the record, of the songwriter's portion, remember, because you're not the publisher. Unless you're publishing the record under your own label or your own entity, you would have 30% of the songwriter, and that would leave 20% for the artist in that case. Okay, so it's up to you how you want to do your, you know, your deals. I mean, that's the flexibility. It's called negotiation. So let's say you charge a flat fee. You'd be exchanging time for money in that case. Okay, whereas if you went with what's called equity or publishing back end, you're escaping time because the ultimate end goal is to license. So you're escaping time at that point. So it's your decision, okay? You make that decision. Is the money more important now or is the money more important later? And how big is the artist? Are they even going to generate enough money to even come close or surpass $500 if you had 30% of 50%, which is really, how much is that? What's that? I don't even know. I can't do backwards math like that. That's too confusing. So if you had 30% of 50% of a record, I guess we'd have that. So you really have 15% in the whole scheme of things. So 15%. So do you really have a lot of equity with just 15% of the whole record? And with that 15%, can the record sell enough to even come close to $500? You can do the math to figure out how much it would take to get $500 with 15% of something. Okay, but that's a decision you have to make. And are you that invested with the artist, et cetera, et cetera? So you can offer all-in-one services. I've heard an interview with a producer who worked his way up from an internship and now owns his own studio. He built it, you know, piece by piece by piece. But in short, what he does is he offers an all-in-one service. He does he calls it the one-stop shop. He has graphics for the artist. He does the music, the recording, the mixing, you know, the whole package, okay? Because music is a package. A song is a product. Notice how a song comes out with cover art. It comes out with video sometimes, like Beyonce's Lemonade. It comes out with, you know, the actual song. So you have to mix it and make it better for the radio or wherever you want to publish the song. So a song is a product. And always remember that. It's a product. So you need to create a great product. When you offer these all-in-one services, you're basically creating a product from scratch with the artist. And that's where you can charge, you know, a lot. You can either charge a flat fee of a lot, or you can charge for a lot of the back-end publishing, or, you know, equity, as they say, or pub, as they say. So that depends on if you're registered as a publisher. That, you know, it really depends on a lot of different things. But you can charge a lot more for that type of service because you're creating the whole thing and you're probably going to be marketing it. So it's basically, I mean, the person's getting a free ride. Not saying that their talent isn't worth it. I'm just saying, you know, you're doing most of the work there. So let's move into the last and final portion of making income as a music producer. Now, the reason I'm separating this service from the rest is because this is time specific. This is based on time. So again, you're going to be exchanging your time for money. Now, this is called one-on-one services. This is where you offer to do something for somebody. Okay, so that could be coaching. You know, it could be, and when I say coaching, I mean vocal coaching, playing, or let's say musicianship. Let's just say music. I don't feel like writing musicianship. Okay, coaching on their product. So again, you got to remember that they're creating a product, so they need consultation for that. You can coach on anything. I'm not even going to write out everything because that would take up the whole page. Okay, now another one-on-one service would be to create the product from scratch. Create full product, meaning that you're creating everything about the song. You're creating the graphics. You're creating the website or whatever you need to make it look cool. You're creating the mixing. You're doing the composition. Okay, you're doing the recording. So you're doing all these things. And basically you're saying, okay, person, come to me, to the producer, and we're gonna create a product. And I'm gonna take a percentage of that product, or I'm gonna take a big flat fee for that product, but I'm gonna get you that product. So this person can't do it alone. So they need you. And you could charge equity, meaning a percentage. This is also called publishing. Let's just call it pub. And then you have, what else do people call it? Equity, percentage, publishing, share, some people call it, points, whatever the term is, it just means percentage. So you're charged, you can either charge a percentage, or you can charge a flat fee, or you can charge both. Sometimes it's a flat fee with percentage. So let's say they come to you and they want a full product. They want the whole shebang. They want you to record the song. They want you to make the beat. They want you to mix the beat. They want you to make the website and do the graphics. Okay, great. I know people who make websites starting at $50,000, and that's just the website, okay? Minimum. So whatever your flat fee may be, I mean, this is a firm that I was talking to. They charge $50,000 minimum for a website. So, I mean, it's not baby money if you offer all these services, okay? But let's just say you're at that level of professionalism. People who charge this much know for sure that they're going to, you know, the client's looking for trust. They want to know that you can create the product and that it will be good and it will work, period. So this might be higher level, obviously. I'm just giving you an idea. So yes, I have dealt with real companies who charge $50,000 minimum for a website. That is not a joke and that's not a made up number, okay? So let's say you're doing all those things. I mean, you can make up your own prices for everything else, but they're coming at you trying to invest money. So one person is trying to invest with you to multiply the money. That's their whole goal, is to multiply the money they invest with you. Okay, you can make that a reality. So let's say this way. You know, I know a lot of dentists, okay, a dentist out of all people who invest in record labels, okay, because they want to escape the time for money game. They want to get out of this thing called the rat race. So they invest in record labels and they multiply the money they invest in record labels. If you've seen artists who, I'm trying to pull out some good examples. If you've seen artists who are just like hot girls, for example, who cannot sing, and I'm not making fun of her, but I'm just saying that she's hot. I think it's her, Erica. Is it Erica? Now I'm forgetting. I might be wrong. Erica Mena from Love and Hip Hop New York. Love and Hip Hop New York. I might be getting her name wrong. But whatever her name is, she's just, you know, a great looking girl. I'm not saying she's the best or worst singer. I'm just saying she tried to sing having no previous, you know, recording history. Okay, so she invested her money to make that producer make her sound good. And now she has a song on YouTube. I think that's her name, Erica Mena from Love in New York, Love in Hip Hop New York. And that she put in the money for, from wherever. It could have been the VH1 investing. It could have been her investing personally, okay? They put in the money, the producer made it a song, okay? And that song did however much. She might be on tour now. She might be on a party tour. She might just be a celebrity now. She might, you know, the song could do so many things for her. So it's an investment, and always remember that, because that's where this money talk comes into play. People are looking to invest in you, and they want to multiply their investment. So always remember that. Keep that at the forefront of your brain. So that's where one-on-one stuff comes into play. But always remember, it's a always comes back to this one thing. Are you exchanging time for money or are you not? So hopefully this answers the question, is the music production career worth it for you? You have to decide which of these lanes you're going to attack and if you're going to implement all the lanes. Just remember, never rely on one source of income. People who only chase placements and only deal with affluent people can also be starving for 5 months because they don't get any work. And the people who only deal with licensing and only deal with, you know, whatever, they might have more leverage because they're escaping this time for money thing. Okay, so you just have to balance out the pros and the cons of each and just have a balanced level. Okay, so a lot of people give praise to the people who are in the quote unquote majors and have a lot of publishing with, you know, artists. But I know also I've heard stories that a lot of major producers are doing worse than people online or people licensing out their work. So don't think that, you know, somebody's above you just because they work with so-and-so. It's not always the case. But it is a great thing to accomplish that you've worked with a great artist. Great. Let's keep it moving. You know, it's social proof. Now let's keep it pushing. So hopefully I'm giving you a reality and show you the possibilities and show you how wide this, you know, production thing is. It's not just artist to artist. You can work with a lot of businesses. We've actually had a client get his song on the Gary V show, I think the intro. Okay, so he made the intro song for Gary V. I've had people go on to win awards, Grammy nominated people. We get so many stories. I mean, we're gonna have to throw some of these stories up on YouTube, some of the testimonials. I mean, some great stories. And it's because they dedicated themselves to their craft and they said, how can I make this work? They didn't stick within the box. They didn't stick within the system. And they found a way to make it work. They said, instead of artist to artist, what if I pitch my song to Gary Vee, a business owner? Wow. You know, nobody thought of that before. Therefore, there's no competition. And he, you know, he won that. And congrats to him. So thank you for watching today. I just want to give you some encouragement and just know that you can do this. And, you know, I really don't understand why a lot of majors and a lot of high level producers try to make music production this, you know, closed circle thing. It's like we have more opportunity nowadays than ever before in the world with this internet thing. And not only with the internet, you can take your efforts from internet to offline as well. But I'm saying the internet gives you reach literally around the world. And we've literally touched every single country. We've trained somebody in every single country. And I have that picture on my Twitter. So, you know, just open your mind. Just don't stay local, because that's what a lot of people do. They only focus on the local people in their city. You know, think worldwide. Okay. And also think more than just putting in time for money. Okay. Think licensing. And don't only think artist to artist. Think, you know, producer to business. Do you know how much money is made in advertisement alone? Do you know how much businesses spend on advertisement? It's insane how much businesses spend on advertisement. And the way they make their ads better is if they add music. Okay. So if they have something that is for sure going to increase what's called conversions or, you know, behavior to their advertisement, they're going to use it. So if the music helps make the ad better, they're going to buy that music to make the ad better. Okay, so you just have to understand how much money is involved in the back end. It's insane. Okay, so thank you for watching today. It's BusyWorksBeats.com.